Hachette Audio presents I Wouldn't Do That If I Were Me, Modern Blunders and Modest Triumphs, but mostly blunders. Written and read by Jason Gay. For my mother, or there be trouble. Chapter 1. VROOM. A couple of years ago, right before the pandemic arrived and the world changed, I took my son Jesse to the Daytona 500. I had no idea the planet was about to shut down, but in retrospect, it was a pretty rowdy way to say farewell to civilization. Jesse was in. I don't even think I got to the second syllable of Daytona. He was 6 years old and obsessed with Hot Wheels, Camaro fumes, and monster trucks. He'd watched Cars 1,000 times, to the point he grew mildly disappointed when the Impala in traffic next to us wasn't anthropomorphically chatting to us through its front bumper. Stock car racing is not for everyone. 4+ hours of Chevys, Fords, and Toyotas making left-hand turns is not a big topic of conversation among the flabby New York City dads I know who bicker about pavement records and drink overrated $6 pour-over iced coffees. But for Jesse, book it. I figured the trip wouldn't be a big hassle. A quick flight from New York City to Orlando, short drive from Orlando to Daytona Beach, and then we'd drive around for 7 or 8 hours looking for parking. Easy peasy. What I didn't count on was what it meant to fly to Orlando. The moment we stepped on the plane, Jesse saw them. Kids dressed in Disney gear, clutching Mickeys and Minnies and doe-eyed princesses of every hairstyle and rank. These kids were not going to the Daytona 500. They were not impressed by a small block 358 CI V8. They were off to the Magic Kingdom, or Animal Kingdom, or Epcot, or Blizzard Beach Water Park, and probably all the above, and I realized that I was going to be spending this trip playing Disney defense against the child who had never been. The arrival at the airport was much worse. Orlando International Airport is basically a portal into the inner ear of Mickey Mouse. From the moment of disembarkation, there is an assault of Disney consumerism, colorful posters advertising new rides and features, kiosks arranging transit and VIP tours, a sprawling gift shop stocked not with the usual assortment of polyblend hoodies and beanbag unicorns, but with stacked shelves of Diz-Biz merchandise. Basically, the airport is the Disney welcome drink, and as Jesse and I move through it, I wish I'd brought him a pair of eye blinders like the ones they put on carriage horses. Are we ever going to go to Disney World? Jesse asked. Not demandingly, but plaintively, as if he were asking if we'd ever see a loggerhead turtle in the wild. This is a delicate question for a parent to answer when they are standing in the kitchen 800 miles from Florida. There's no satisfying way to answer it when standing in the middle of Orlando International Airport, when there are shuttle buses outside the door ready to take you, when the entire momentum of the facility is designed to deposit you at the doorstep of Walt's Xanadu within 15 or so minutes. No response is sufficient. You can't give your kid a lame excuse about the timing or the season or your inability to find plane tickets. You are literally here. So the only humane thing you could do is to escape, to grab your child by the hand and march them wordlessly to the rental car counter where families waiting in line are, damn it, already in mouse ears. But Jesse didn't toss a fit. I was grateful. He was too focused on Daytona and he seemed to buy my limp suggestion of a Disney rain check. We got on the road to the Speedway, and once we got clear of the greater Mickeyopolis, we had a lengthy conversation about the respective driving talents of NASCAR heroes like Denny Hamlin, Kyle Busch, Ryan Blaney, and Martin Truex Jr. All right, fine, that's not true. We didn't know a thing. I had managed to negotiate my way into middle age and a sports columnist job with barely a passing knowledge of anything to do with one of America's greatest spectator sports. If you are embarrassed by this admission, imagine how I feel. It's embarrassing for a person paid to write about sports to not know the difference between Bristol and Talladega, or have the first idea what happens when a car rolls into pit road. They pump up the tires? I don't know. I was the worst sort of urbane caricature. I, too, am a flabby dad with opinions about pavement records and overrated $6 pour-over iced coffee. I'd faked my way through a few interviews with NASCAR talent by asking basic questions. How's your parallel parking? I didn't know anything, and it was a little mortifying and probably professionally disqualifying. I admit it. Mea culpa. Now, please don't ask me about hockey. Jesse was my vessel here. You know, he might have thought he was my Mary plus one, but he was going to be Daddy's portal into the whole Daytona experience. I could write about what it was like to be here, eyes of the child, the whole bit. I could cover Daytona without actually covering Daytona. I could cover it as a dad. Aw, barf, done. Daytona, well, it was a circus atop a circus, hours from race time, miles of cars, flags, and brightly sunburned, tattooed flesh. Blasting music, loud tailpipes, mirrored sunglasses, it felt like being in a Kid Rock video without being in a Kid Rock video. From a highway overpass, a gathering of apocalyptics held block-letter signs warning of the Earth's impending doom. The usual culprits were blamed. Atheists, hedonists, pansexuals, non-NASCAR watchers, movie stars, kale eaters, pleasure fornicators. What are pleasure fornicators? Jesse asked. Okay, he didn't ask that. Jesse was on the edge of reading, but not totally there yet. I was grateful for this, as we passed the lively doomsdayists and their megaphones. But he did know one word, Trump. And that word hovered over the entire day because he was coming, the 45th president, due in from Palm Beach just down the coast. Trump was coming to tell the drivers to start their engines and who knew what else, and it meant oodles of increased security around the track. It also meant that the 60-second running of this event would become something of a quasi-political rally, a red hat flag plant in a state that at the time was considered up for grabs in the 2020 election. It very much was not, as it turned out. Then, outside a Bass Pro Shop, across from the track, Jesse spotted it. An air rifle tent. A child half of Jesse's size stood at the entrance, gripping a BB rifle, pop, pop, popping away like Chuck Connors with a Winchester. Can we do that? Jesse asked. Nothing has really underlined my sheltered, soft-fingered, Acela Corridor existence more than the first time my son asked me if he could fire a rifle. Even this, a mild-mannered BB rifle designed for kids, represented a yawning detachment from all the values that my wife Bessie and I had attempted to instill in Jesse. Guns of any kind were forbidden in our home, even toy ones. Jesse was being raised to deploy his aggression only through wrestling family members and writing Yelp reviews. No way was I going to allow him to start blasting away with a BB rifle. Sure, I said. The milestones in a child's life are not always recognizable. Sometimes they don't become evident until years later. But this felt like one in the moment. I kept a close watch as the supervisor at the tent handed Jesse the BB gun and gave him a 15-minute instruction on safety. I'm kidding. He basically gave him the gun and said, "Have at it, kid." Which Jesse happily did for the next 5 minutes, the supervisor occasionally looking up from his phone to see if anybody had lost an eye. Jesse did not appear to be a born shot, and my hope was that he'd somehow find it not so entertaining or frustrating or even kind of boring, and he would internalize his parents' strict stance on weaponry and never want to do it again. "That was amazing," Jesse said. To see a car race in the flesh is to be reminded, as with many events, that television is a lousy substitute for the in-person thing. Daytona, like all NASCAR fair, is cacophonously, molar-rattlingly loud. Earplugs are not a recommendation, but a must, and I'm not talking about the doughy plugs you roll in your ears as you nuzzle into seat 35B. I'm talking about those ear-smothering cans that look like they contain transistor radios and get worn when you're chainsawing a redwood. President Trump, now in the House, does his thing. It's a brief speech, capped by the "gentlemen, start your engines" bit, and then he steps inside his beefy executive limousine, nicknamed the Beast, and takes a slow twirl around the track as the Daytona field follows behind. Jesse's never seen a president before. Now I'm thinking of him in his 70s and being asked by a grandchild, "When was the first time you saw a president?" "Well, I did see one drive slowly in a car around a track at the Daytona 500. Whereupon his grandkids will ask, "People used to drive cars?" When the race starts, you can feel that vroom in your bones. It's hard to communicate to Jesse what's going on because it's so loud. Another reason it's hard to communicate what's going on is because I have no idea what's going on. I may as well have brought him to a Russian dinner theater. I know the basics of car racing, first car across wins, and everything from there, well, is a spectacular guess. Who's going to win? They pit the cars. How? They need to change the tires. Why? I have no answers. The kid has never been more disappointed in his father. I'm a sad dad who is equipped to explain to his son the finer points of Arcade Fire, but I'm useless here. I suddenly wish I'd taken him to Disney World.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.